Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. In my research preparing for the cruise along the Douro River in Portugal, I came across an absolutely amazing character that I really have to look more deeply into, but his life is somewhat mysterious. And let me just tell you what I know. His name is Duarte de Paz. He was a Portuguese diplomat who was of crypto-Jewish origins, which means his parents were likely converted in the forced conversion of 1496-97 in Portugal, and he was born around 1500. He died sometime after 1552. It's not exactly clear what happened at the end of his life, as you shall see in a minute, but he had this remarkable career lobbying popes to hold off persecuting other Portuguese crypto Jews. And it's just mind-boggling what he got away with. I came across this in the Encyclopedia Judaica, which was updated in 2007, but there was some other research that was obviously not included as they updated their article, and I found a great article by Carlos Manuel Valentim at the University of Lisbon, and a really interesting article by James Nelson Novoa based on Vatican secret archives that were recently updated. He's with the Cátedra de Estudos Sefarditas Alberto Benaviste. Fascinating material. So here's the story with De Paz. He was the oldest of six children, and he was born around 1500, right? So his parents had just been forcibly converted to Christianity, and for the first few decades of the 16th century, you know, the Portuguese Jews were feeling very resentful of this moment, of course, but nevertheless, they had the rights as Christians to do whatever they wanted, and they could practice Judaism in secret, primarily because King Manuel I, who had like a larger geopolitical agenda, he wanted to unite with Spain, and he didn't want to expel the Jews of Portugal, many of whom, by the way, were originally refugees from Spain. He wanted to keep them in Portugal for their economic talents and value and investments and so on. So he simply mass converted them against their will. So he, in exchange for that act, he promised them that he would hold off on allowing the Inquisition coming into Portugal. And in fact, he did so for quite a while. So our hero, De Paz, was the oldest of six children, and the family was very involved in the Douro region. Actually, they're based in Porto, which is where the Douro River empties out into the Atlantic, and they had a lot of business up and down the river. De Paz ended up going into the military, and he actually lost an eye fighting for Portugal in a war in North Africa. But he still maintained very heavy connections with very important crypto-Jewish families like the Nassi family of Doña Gracia Mendez Nassi and Joseph Nassi and others. Now you have to imagine this individual, a decorated soldier with one eye, kind of like a Moshe Dayan kind of look. We don't have pictures of him, but he probably wore an eye patch. And he rose up in the ranks until finally King John III, who actually, I'm going to pronounce his name for him, João III. I have to give thanks to Helena of Brazil, who now lives in Melbourne, for sending me notes on how to pronounce João properly. I used to think it was João, like when the baby was born, the mother would say, João, it's a boy. But it's actually João. Anyway, sorry for that distraction. King João III named him to the Military Order of Christ. This is a former Templar organization, like Knights of Templar. And this was in 1530 when he was about 30 years old. And he apparently wore the habit of the Order of Christ, the Military Order of Christ, in his travels. We don't have a picture of him, but here's a picture of the very famous Marquis de Pombal, who was also a member of the Military Order of Christ, and he is wearing the official cross that is so, you know, associated with Portugal and specifically this 16th century. So that's what he must have dressed like. So he went off on a secret mission for King João III, but then apparently he diverted. He abandoned whatever that mission was, and he decided he was going to spend time in Rome lobbying on behalf of his brethren, the Portuguese crypto Jews. We have to imagine that he carried with him a massive amount of money, which was provided for him by the crypto Jewish community of Portugal. And he went to Pope Clement VII and actually got the Pope to cancel the Inquisition in Portugal. It's amazing. The year before, the Pope had issued this papal bull, Cum ad nihil magis, which was formally allowing the Inquisition to come to Portugal. And with this bag of money, De Paz was able to set it off single-handedly, rather amazingly. And it wasn't only Pope Clement VII. The next Pope, Paul III, was also very involved with De Paz. And apparently, this is amazing, De Paz was able to get Pope Paul III to actually pardon 1,800 Portuguese crypto-Jews who had been arrested for secretly practicing Judaism and have them released from these Portuguese dungeons. 1,800 people. It's just incredible. After Pope Paul III, who was in office until 1549, we find out that De Paz's career goes definitely downhill. King João is very upset because he learned that De Paz is not doing whatever secret mission he sent him on, and instead is out there lobbying for crypto-Jews in Rome. So he strips him of his office, demands that he stop wearing the insignia and so on, and possibly was behind an assassination attempt that apparently De Paz was attacked on the road while traveling. He was stabbed 14 times and left for dead on the road, but luckily, or with foresight, I really should say, he was wearing some kind of secret armor underneath his clothing, and he was able to survive that attack. He was rescued, he was actually brought to the doctors of the Pope who treated him, and he was able to eventually heal and then move on. During this time, however, and it gets really murky, he apparently had significant disputes with his financial backers who were questioning exactly how he was spending his money, and he was replaced by another representative, Diogo Antonio, and De Paz was furious. He ends up in Ferrara, Italy in 1538, and he is jailed at that point. This is when the Inquisition is really rocking through Italy and Spain and Portugal at this time. After spending an unknown amount of time in jail, he was released, and he immediately fled to Istanbul, which was a destination for many of these crypto-Jews because there they could openly practice Judaism. I know it might sound ironic in our 10th, 21st century, but in the 16th century, crypto-Jews found a much more hospitable environment for their return to Judaism in Islamic lands than they did in Catholic lands. So De Paz actually openly came out as a Jew. He changed his name to David Bueno, and then we're not exactly sure what happened to him afterwards. Documents released from the Vatican include some reports of De Paz. It's difficult to determine exactly how authoritative they are, but one of the Catholic reporters who describes the story of De Paz says that after De Paz abnegated his Christian faith, not only did he return to his Hebrew perfidy, right? He actually converted to the Turkish sect, meaning to Islam. So it's hard to determine whether or not that is true. It seems like the author of this letter is probably saying that not only did he become a Jew, even worse, he became a Muslim. So it may be just some kind of empty calumny. But what we can say about De Paz is that he lived an extremely colorful life, very heroic individual who actually did tremendous things for the Portuguese crypto-Jewish community. Wow. I hope you found this interesting, and I'm looking forward to talking with you more about the amazing history of the Jews of the Douro River. And I hope you'll be able to join us on this cruise in 2024. Thank you very much for watching.